How about a couple more fogs? Evaporation fog. You've seen this one before. This is fog that appears as a mist over a body of water. Have you noticed this, like at a park or something early in the morning? There'll be this little bit of a discombobulated mist that's lying over the top of a stream or a little lake or something. It's formed when cold air settles over a relatively warm body of water. Remember, cold air cannot hold a lot of water. That's the nature of it. It's the smaller glass, not the bigger glass, the proverbial atmospheric glass. And the atmosphere acts like a sponge. It wants to absorb moisture. And at the same time, warm water is going to want to evaporate into the air. If you take a look at this, you can see it's perfect in a lot of ways, this diagram, because you can see there's a mountain range in the background. So the air on top of the mountain range settles at night. So it sinks, it subsides, it descends at night. And that cold air then settles over the top of that warmer body of water. Cold air cannot hold a lot of water, but the warm water wants to evaporate and it begins to condense. And it makes a very misty kind of fog. If you look at this picture, you can see in the background, this is the Teton Range in Wyoming, 14,000 feet high in some places. Where the arrow's pointing is an evaporation fog that's formed over the top of Jackson Lake. You can tell this is in the morning. The tops of the mountains are illuminated, but the bottom of the mountain has not been illuminated yet because the sun has not gotten completely above the horizon. And what happened was at night, cold air came down the sides of the mountain, settled over the top of that significantly warmer body of water, which is Jackson Lake. And because of that, that cold air cannot hold a lot of water, but of course, Jackson Lake's evaporating moisture in the atmosphere and this misty evaporation fog formed. This is the Snake River, which flows out of Jackson Dam, which is next to Jackson Lake. And if you look carefully right there, you can see that there's this mist lying over the top. This is also early in the morning, lying over the top of the Snake River. That's evaporation fog. And it's just because cold air settled over a relatively warm body of water. The last of the fogs is upslope fog. And you can see with this diagram, not the greatest diagram in the world, but it'll do. Air is flowing along from left to right. As the air is flowing along, it hits the mountain. When it begins to rise up along the slopes of the mountain, the temperature of the air drops. Remember, when air temperature goes down, relative humidity goes up. And at some point, the air temperature reaches dew point temperature. And when that happens, the fog forms. So upslope fog is fog produced by the movement of relatively moist air upwards along the sides of a mountain. The air cools on the way up, causing the relative humidity to increase, reach saturation, and condense. This is a place where I used to own a house in the Czech Republic. And if you look, I was at my friend's guest house. We got up early in the morning, the air started to rise along the sides of the mountain, and an upslope fog began to form. And I waited around, took another picture, and you could see the fog was getting denser and denser. Then we had something to do, so I left, so I didn't finish taking the pictures. But you can see what's happening. The air's going up along the sides of the mountain. You see the bottom of the cloud. That's where the air is first reaching the dew point temperature, and the relative humidity is 100%, and the air is saturating. As the air continues to move up along the side of the mountain, the fog continues to form. This is in the Alps. My wife and I got up very early and took a tram up to the top of the mountains. It was absolutely clear. This is out of Chamonix in France. And you could see everything. You see the bottom of the valley floor. But by about 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, the ground started to get warm. The air began to rise. And as it did, it began to create this cloud along the sides of the mountain, which is upslope fog. And by noon, 2 o'clock, you can't see the mountains at all. It gets completely covered in. This is pretty much a daily occurrence that the air will rise up along the slopes of the mountains and then condense and shroud the mountains in clouds. So there's two ways to change relative humidity, change air temperature and change specific humidity. Why does dew form on the outside of your car's windshield? And why does dew form on the inside of your car's windshield? Do you know why that happens? One of these has to do with changing air temperature. The other has to do with changing specific humidity. The one on the outside of your windshield is because at night, the temperature drops. temperature of the car drops, and the air in contact with it drops. And eventually it reaches the dew point temperature and the relative humidity is 100%. On the inside of your windshield, well, imagine that you are sitting inside your car, it's night, the car is parked, the windows are rolled up, and you're breathing. I wear glasses, okay, sometimes. So if I breathe in my glasses, listen. When I do that, moisture forms on the lens of my glass. So if you're sitting in the car, especially if you're sitting in the car with another person, and both of you are breathing, like hopefully you are exhaling moisture into the atmosphere, and you are effectively changing the specific humidity. It's like pouring water into a 12-ounce glass. If you keep pouring, eventually you fill the glass up and water comes out. And so you have effectively changed the specific humidity, which changes the relative humidity, and you fill the car up with water, 100% relative humidity, the water's got to come out, it comes out on the windshield. Why do you feel more uncomfortable on a day when it's 90 degrees and 80% relative humidity than on a day when it's 90 degrees and 20% relative humidity? Like, for example, a day in Atlanta during the summer versus a day in Los Angeles during the summer. Well, what's your body's mechanism for cooling itself off? Sweating. And in order for sweat to operate correctly, the water comes out on your skin and it evaporates into the atmosphere. In order for it to evaporate, the water molecules that are in the sweat have to get energy, heat up, speed up, and then transfer themselves from the liquid state into the gaseous state. When they do that, they are absorbing energy to do that, and they get that energy from your body. And then your body's energy is transferred in the atmosphere, which thereby cools your body because your body's losing energy through the evaporation process. Remember, evaporation is a cooling process. And on a day when the relative humidity is 80% and the temperature is 90, there's just not a lot of places to put water into the atmosphere. And so your body struggles to get that water off of itself. And the result is you don't cool down. Whereas on a day when it's 90 degrees and 20% relative humidity, the water is just evaporating in the atmosphere very readily, and that keeps your body cooler.